Hello, this is BSJ, and this video is going to be a semi-partial follow-up to my How to Win Your Lane in 6.88 with my Pulling a 53 video. So I'm going to touch on a lot of important aspects of the laning stage, little tips and tricks that you can do to make sure you do these aspects better, and then I'm going to use this first replay, which is a coaching session of a 4K player that I talked a lot about this with, in comparison to myself, which I'll be showing you two separate games with similar scenarios that are handled differently by a 4K player and a 7K player, and how my understanding and approach to the game is going to be very clear between the distinction of these two games. Not to harp on this 4K player, because he has the right mindset in terms of how he's trying to apply aggression in lane with an aggressive carry. There's basically check marks in the laning stage, and that's what a lot of players aren't looking at, a lot of things they don't think about. So that's what we're going to talk about in this replay analysis video, as well as how to win your lane. So the first thing, I'm just going to talk about aspects of laning. So this is, like I said, basically a follow-up to how to win your lane, pulling a 53 video. So in last patch, right, before this patch, whenever the lane pushed, you could just pull the lane at 53, stack pull the big camp, deny the entire wave to the enemy, and get XP for yourself. That, in my opinion, was like the entire decider of the safe lane and the off lane. Whoever could do that better would just win the lane. Because if you controlled the lane, you could push it out, you could pull it, you could body them from the pull, basically denying them the entire wave. Creeps gave even less than 50% XP in that patch. But now, the creeps that die to jungle camps are basically denied 50%, so they're like normal denies, which isn't nearly as beneficial as it used to be. And you can only stack pull at odd minutes. So that's changed the entire dynamic of the safe lane. And that's just reality. And what I want you guys to look at, you know, clearing your thoughts, it's not important that last patch you thought, I need to pull a 53 to win the lane, right? You need to understand why you were pulling a 53 to win the lane. So basically what pulling a 53 did was it controlled the lane equilibrium, right? You could push out the lane, and then by pulling it, it effectively reset the equilibrium because you pushed and killed their wave and then your wave died. So both waves are dead way ahead of time, and then the waves would just meet once again in like the neutral spot that they usually do. And that was the best way to control the lane because it allowed you to be aggressive. Because aggression pushes waves. We've talked about this before, but if you're aggressive, the enemy creeps are going to aggro you. And if they're attacking you, they're not attacking your own creeps, which means your creeps are killing them, but their creeps are not killing yours. And that is going to push the lane. So aggression is the key to playing the safe lane. I've talked about many times that it's basically the biggest limiting factor in farm is the enemies killing you. And the enemy's threatening to kill you. Enemy's bullying you. So the way to spur your farm ahead is by minimizing their ability to kill you. And the way to minimize their ability to kill you is to deny XP and gold as much as possible. The whole lane is about who can get more gold and XP out of it. That's really, it's that simple, but it's not. You know what I mean? That's your simple goal, but the way to accomplish that is not nearly as straightforward as, you know, saying you need to get more gold and XP from the enemy. So what I'm going to talk about with aggression is aggression can be harassing. It can be going for kills. It can be, you know, positioning yourself such that you are bodying them from the lane on a hero like Ursa, because if they come close to you, you'll hit them. Aggression comes in a lot of forms is basically what I'm trying to say. And I also said that it's going to push the lane. So in prior patches, before this one with the pull at 53, I didn't care if I pushed the lane at any given point because I could just push the lane out, pull at 53, and I would get all the denies in the world that I wanted on the enemy offlaner or enemy laner, you know, dual lane, whatever. But in this patch, yes, pulling a 53 is available, but it's available not nearly as often. So if I lose control of the lane, you know, at a minute 15 seconds, I've lost that control of the lane until 3 minutes in. That's like detrimental, you know, that's huge compared to last patch. So my goal is for me to be aggressive, I now have to first check off that the laning equilibrium is where I want it to be. So something we're going to be seeing in a bit here is it's really important in this consideration when going for kills. I made a replay analysis video of Lifestealer that's going to come out at the same time this one does. And what I emphasized in that game at one point was I had to make sure the lane was pushing towards me first before I wanted to be aggressive. a lot of the time. It's not 100% of the time, but when it comes to in the early game, this is almost always the case. I wanted the lane to be pushing towards me so that when I'm aggressive and I push the lane slightly by being aggressive, that the lane equilibrium will not be lost. And the reason why I say this is you have to ask yourself, why am I going for kills in the laning stage? And the fact is, in the laning stage, most of the time, especially super early on, the only thing that kills do is give you golden XP. So if you get golden XP out of getting the kill, but at the same time you push the wave into their tower with three range creeps and they teleport back in after dying and get a free, you know, two levels off of that creep wave, your kill did not accomplish anything. It's really that simple. Like, yeah, it gave you golden XP, but like I said, the main hindrance on your farm is the golden XP that the enemy is getting. So it's not worth getting slightly more XP and gold by killing the guy in order to give them a free level 3 on the offlaner. And that's like something you can watch that Lifestealer video to show that I applied aggression after I knew the lane wasn't going to push. So once he died, he wasn't getting like free levels off of the lane. He just died, right? It's good to capitalize on when they're out of position and killing them, but your first priority has to be lane equilibrium, period. I'll ask my coaching students, do you think it's worth missing 5 CS in the first 4 minutes in order to ensure that the lane is good equilibrium? And quite frankly, most people said no. And my response is, well, if you have good equilibrium usage and you can apply aggression because of that, and you're level 5 and the enemy's level 4, would you then give up 5 CS for that? And people said, well, that I don't really think about it that way. And my answer for you is absolutely. That is absolutely worth giving up CS for that. And you're going to see in my replay version that there are times I'm going to miss CS because I'm trying to keep the lane back at all costs, because if I push it into their tower, they're going to get free XP that I shouldn't be letting them get in a lane like this, right? Not every lane are you the dominant safe laner, but if you have a tri lane or like against a dual lane or a dual lane against a solo lane, it's the equilibrium is of the utmost importance. And it matters in solo v solos, but that's like a whole nother ball game that, for the sake of this video, don't worry about. It doesn't apply exactly what I'm talking about. So we're going to see here that the first thing he does right away, compared to what I did in the Lifestealer video and what you're going to see in my video coming up, he attacks the creeps. And his reasoning was that if he sets up the creeps with Fury Swipes, then it'll secure his last hits because he'll be doing more damage. And that's something that makes sense, right? But that is a luxury. And you have to think about any luxuries or advantages you can get in lane, what do they cost you, right? A lot of them have a price. And in this case, it's pushing the lane. So that's not something you want to be doing. This would have worked fine if he had the Lion pull at 53 right off the bat, because the camps do spawn at 30 seconds and then a minute, so you can get a quick pull off. But I generally don't like pulling right away in games like this, because good players will contest you properly. They're just not going to let you do it this early on because you're all level 1. Like, nobody's significantly stronger than the other, and they'll just contest you. And I don't mind like stacking super early, but I don't like generally pulling. There are some unique matchups where it is okay, but for the sake of simplicity, we'll say that it's not. So his luxury is that it's going to push out the lane. Right? His luxury of getting more damage for the creep CS is that it's going to push out the lane. So the next step I asked him is, well, for when they're contesting you, but you're in a tri-lane versus dual lane. And so the first thing I want to point out to you guys is that Fury Swipes damage is only useful if his CS is getting contested, right? You shouldn't be babying yourself through CS. Like, you shouldn't be doing this just because you want to make it more likely that you get the CS. You should be doing this, the Fury Swipes damage thing, or other tactics such as this, in order to make sure you get the CS because you're fighting for them with the enemy team, right? You don't want them to get those denies. But in this lane dynamic with two supports and an Ursa, is it likely that his CS is going to get contested? And you're going to see right away that the enemy is not contesting it at all, right? He's just killing the creeps, and now the lane's pushed out, right? And not only is the lane pushing out going to give the enemy team free XP and gold because it's within their, like, near their tower, but it also makes it so they can't be aggressive. Like, if Ursa were to posture aggressively, right now, at this very moment, he were to walk at the Wind Ranger would be forced to run away. And the second he gets, like, near the tower, the Wind Ranger, if she's a smart player, can just turn and start right-clicking him, knowing that if he walks into tower range, she's going to win that trade. So having the lane before like this makes his aggressive potential that much less. So, like, we're looking at trades. And the reason why I'm talking about aggression is because aggression in the right times is how you capitalize and how you win trades. So if you're not being aggressive at the right times and you're not creating the right situations to be aggressive, you're going to lose trades, period. And if you lose trades, you're going to be the level 4 at 4 minutes and the enemy offlaner is going to be level 5. And then you're going to get bullied out of lane the minute they hit 6 and your farm is going to suffer for it. This is all a snowball effect that we'll be able to see in this game. So right away, I like that he pulled the creeps. He could have pulled them to his range creep there, but he didn't quite do it. He told me that that was his intention, so that's something that you can do to pull the lane back. I talk about that in my Lifestealer video as well. But notice, in a lane where he should be able to be aggressive, he has Gale for slow, he has Lion for stun, and he's a really strong laning hero in the Ursa. And now, he's just giving free XP to these heroes under their tower. So they're able to get the pull off, which is actually kind of nice because they deny half the wave, something you can do without stacking. But there's going to be a whole nother video for that one because it's a little bit complicated on how to make sure you get half the creeps. But they do capitalize and get a nice kill here. And like, this is nice aggression, but look at the lane, right? It's still at their tower. And when they TP back into the lane, what are they getting? The clock is just getting XP. If you look at the difference in the game of Lifestealer that I showed, the Nyx Assassin would TP back in and get nothing out of it. In this game, he TPs back in and just gets free XP, all because the lane is pushed. And that's something that we're not worrying about lane equilibrium before we're going for aggression. And I'm saying that if you want to go for aggression, lane equilibrium has to be first priority. So now the lane's in a decent spot. I'm okay with where it's at now, but notice how, right away, his manipulation of the lane is going to push the lane. So this is something that I look out for. The crucial aspect of lane equilibrium, period, guys, is the range creeps, period. There are times where if someone pulls and the range creep somehow dies and now they have 7 melee creeps and the enemy team has 4, the lane will push. That happens, like, rarely, but it does happen. But the entire focus of the lane pushing is range creeps, whether or not it's going to push. So one key difference we're going to see here in between this game and the one I'm going to show you next with my Juggernaut replay is his aggression is going to come when he has not taken care of the lane equilibrium first. So my example of this would be right now, the enemy range creep is going to die and his is not. So quickly you ask yourself, as a carry, what do I do to solve that? That's like the first step to solving this problem. What can I do to make it so that this is not happening? So what I would do is move my camera forward, A click the clockwork or the Windranger, and drag this melee creep to this range creep, ensuring that it's going to die. And then, if I see a good time to be aggressive, that's when it's correct to be aggressive. But if I go aggressive right now, in the current state of the lane, this is what I'm pointing out, and this is what you need to realize when you're looking to be aggressive, but you always need to be looking to be aggressive, is that the lane's going to push towards these guys. So once the aggression's over, whether it ends in a kill or not, which makes it high risk, low reward, they're going to get free XP because the lane's going to push into their tower. That's the key here, guys. That's what I'm looking at. Making sure you're set up for aggression by having the lane not pushing towards them when you do it. So notice the lane's going to be pushing and he's going to walk forward in order to be aggressive. And like, I like his idea of being aggressive. And this is what I'm trying to say is like, he has the right concept. He should be being aggressive in this lane, but he needs to be setting himself up for success with that aggression. And notice here that the lane's going to push because of that lack of that oversight that he had. Look, now he has 2 range creeps. Now the lane is pushing, and like, he tries to recover it. He's dragging the melee creeps towards him, and that's something where he should have dragged them again after the creep aggro. I have a whole video on creep aggro talking about the mechanics behind it. If you don't understand creep aggro in terms of how it works with the 2.5 seconds and how they de-aggro and the range and everything, you should definitely check that out. It is also on Game Leap. I highly recommend that you should understand creep aggro before watching this video. So notice here, like I said, lane's pushing. So he's going to give them all the XP and all the gold, and he's not going to be able to punish it at all. And that's what I'm looking at, right? And now we're going to see, so we're just going to keep fast forwarding through the lane, that my emphasis here is that you're not going to see the impact of this now. You're going to see it when the enemy gets their level 6s and the levels and the items they need, and they're going to start pressuring you and limiting your farm because of the fact that they have all this extra free XP and gold that you gave them by playing the lane the way that you did. Notice how something you're going to see in my game, he hasn't dragged the melee creeps of the enemy to his own range creep at all. So that's going to be one of the key tips and tricks. So I said, the key is your range creeps. The lane's going to pull back if your range creep is dead, period. So one thing you can do is dragging in the melee creeps of the enemy by A-clicking and using aggro to your range creep. And so you're going to see here that he hasn't done that a single time. And so I'm going to wait to exactly show you what I'm talking about until I show you my replay in order to show you how often I do it in lane. And it's not like rocket science. You just need to look out for doing it and then do it. Learn how to do it yourself and you'll just get it done, right? And notice here that, like, yeah, they get kills. Those are nice. Like, the enemy misplayed. That was actually just enemy misplaying, being a little over-aggressive. But now, look at the lane, right? Look at the lane, guys. He's getting golden XP from getting these kills, but the enemy is just getting free XP, right? Like, he pushed the lane in, and he's barely level 5, and this Clockwork's almost level 4.5, and this Windranger's the same level as he is. So the enemy offlane is getting just as much golden XP out of this lane, or at least as much XP, than he is, because of the way that the lane equilibrium is being managed. And now, this kind of stuff leads to these kills, where, you know, his teammates are dying because of the high levels that he's been giving to the offlane. Obviously, is it all his fault that the lane's been played the way it is? Absolutely not. Like, there could have been, like, better pull play coming out for the supports, but the fact is he could have done what needed to be done to keep the lane in a good spot. And that's what we're looking at. We're not looking at, like, team coordination and pubs and, like, perfectly executing lanes. We're looking at the carry role and everything that you can do in order to ensure that your lane goes ideally. So now we move on to my replay analysis, where we're gonna now compare how I approach the lane to the previous coaching session with the 4K student. So one of the first things I wanna point out is in the last replay, we talked about how the range creeps are the essential part of lane equilibrium. So first thing you're gonna see me do here is something you should try to do every single game, is that I'm gonna block for the range creep to be in front. So one of the concepts I wanna talk about with why you want the range creep to be in front, and also like the idea of the range creeps, is that I've talked about this in other videos, that range creeps do piercing damage. They do 35 damage per volley, while melee creeps do about 21. So assuming that the offlaner did the same thing, where he blocked for his range creep to die first, I asked one of my coaching students the other day, who's 5.2k, and I asked him, would you rather have it so that at the beginning of the lane, both range creeps live or both range creeps die? Meaning that your allied range creep and the enemy range creep live and die. And he said, I would rather have neither. I'd rather have mine die and the enemies live. He thought I was like trying to ask him a trick question. And what I'm trying to say is, in an ideal world, both players are going to try to block so that the range creeps are in front. And I said, you're not going to get the ideal situation of having yours die and his not. That's like the ideal world, but that's not going to happen with like an even matchup. So we ended up talking about why one of them is beneficial to the other. So his initial response was, I'd rather have both range creeps live. So what I talked about in the last video is that way to win a lane is aggression. And the way to be aggressive is to make sure that your lane equilibrium is intact. It's not going to push. So one of the reasons why it's so nice to have the range creeps die, so I'm going to tell you right off the bat that the correct answer is that you want both range creeps to die, is that you have obligations in lane. Talked about this in other videos, talked about this in my coaching sessions. And the first obligation as a carry that a lot of people realize is that you need to farm. You need to get gold and XP, and you need to get the last hits to get that gold. So the amount of time that you have to harass is limited if the creeps are dying faster, right? And what I mean by that is if one of the enemy creeps is low health, you don't have time to harass because you need to be getting that last hit. So I really like the way to think about why killing the enemy range creep and your own range creep is beneficial, is because the creeps are dying slower, the melee creeps that remain in the lane. This makes it so that you have more time to harass. And also, you have a heavier impact on the lane equilibrium, meaning that both sides are not pushing as hard. So if you start like auto attack denying one of your creeps at low health, or auto attack pushing the lane, you have more impact overall on the control of the lane because the creeps are doing less. So your percentage impact is simply more, and it's also that you have more time to harass. So you saw here that I blocked for my range creep to die, and that immediately is a contrast to what we saw in the first replay, is that my lane is going to be set up to push against me right off the bat rather than I'm pushing it towards the enemy from the get-go. So I make sure I get the deny on the range creep, one of the key focuses of the lane. The Bristleback obviously isn't showing himself just yet, but notice how like every time a creep's below half, I'm denying it. Everything I'm doing is setting up for a denying of the wave rather than pushing it.
Like, everything I do, look at the lane. If I were to be aggressive right now, which I'm looking for the Bristleback, we don't know exactly where he is, I'm free to do so because the lane is pulling back towards me. And now I see him, and I make sure that the lane doesn't go too far towards me. So notice how once I knew that the lane was in a good spot, meaning like my whole creep wave was dead, but my other creep wave was coming in, I didn't want my other creep wave to be too pushed into me. If I let the enemy get like three range creeps and I have zero and it's shoving into my tower, that's when they can like dive you when they're a dual lane, that kind of stuff. It also makes it really hard for you to CS under tower because you're tanking so much damage from the creeps. You want the lane to be pulling towards you, but not too much, right? So notice how the minute that I had it in a correct spot and I knew that the lane was already pushing towards me enough, I immediately shifted focus to pushing the lane back out with my auto attacks on enemy creeps. So you see here, I'm able to be aggressive because exactly what I talked about. Using that spin just to get a lot of damage on the Bristle. And the lane was already pushing towards me slightly because my last creep wave died before his did and took more damage to begin with. Like, if we rewind just to show you exactly what I'm talking about. Notice how his two remaining creeps from the first wave almost killed an entire melee creep. So meaning that the next wave, like the second wave that are going to collide, I have basically one less melee creep, which makes the lane pushing towards me, which allows me to do what I do with this spin here to get aggression and damage onto the Bristleback. And that's important. And I talked about trades, winning trades. That's how you win lanes, guys. And notice how, like, basically now, because I spin, that pushed the wave. That dragged my melee creeps to his range creep, pushing the wave. And also, some of my spin did damage to the creeps. But notice how my lane is not irreparably pushed because the fact that I can now A-click aggro the Bristleback, drag the creeps to my range creep, and because the creep wave was already pushing towards me slightly, I have not lost control of the wave. That allowed me to be aggressive, allowed me to get a good trade, allowed my Pudge to go on the Bristleback here, get some decent damage. I don't really like this move by the Pudge. I talked about like how it allowed my Pudge to do this. And this is a replay that came from, like, before I truly understand exactly how I wanted to approach these lanes. And if I was, like, communicating with this Pudge, like, on an active level, like, say on, like, a, you know, professional level, or he's, like, a friend of mine that we're pubbing with in a voice chat, I would have told him not to go there for several reasons. One, because his rot's going to push the wave that he just ran into. And two, we're looking for advantageous trades. And on a hero like Juggernaut in the early game, the way for me to get advantageous trades is spin, right? And that's on cooldown. So notice how that trade did not go so well. And that's important to recognize, is like part of applying your aggression and getting trades is what the condition is for your aggression to be favorable, right? And like whether that be an ability cooldown, whether that be you have full health, full mana, whether, you know, whatever those conditions are, trying to recognize them when you're being aggressive. And for me in this lane, it's very straightforward. I need to be spinning on the Bristleback, otherwise it's not to my benefit. And you're gonna see here now, because of that, you know, kind of bad step by the Pudge and me allowing it to happen, look at the lane equilibrium. It's already pushing towards the Bristleback. And this is something as a player that you need to immediately recognize every single time a creep wave collides. Is it pushing towards me? Is it pushing like towards the enemy? Like, do I want that to happen? What can I do to fix it one way or the other? And in this case, you're gonna see my immediate reaction. I'm gonna play aggressively on him, and then the minute a creep gets low, I'm gonna deny it. That I actually should have done, like, auto attack denied that twice, but I did not. So that is a slight misplay on my part. But noticing how I'm always pulling the way back, we get a nice hook on the Bristle, and we go for this kill. So here's the deal with this first kill in lane. In a contrast to one more replay I'm going to show just briefly at the end of this, is that if you look at the timer, it's 2 minutes. So if we get this kill, and we want to stack pull a 53 to recover the lane, we're going to have to wait two whole creep waves to do that. And this Bristleback's kind of getting owned in lane. And I mean, like, yeah, he's getting a decent amount of XP, but if you look at his last hits, like, he hasn't walked up and gotten any, right? He hasn't gotten any. So giving him, like, any last hits and, like, me not getting the deny under their tower pretty much makes this kill neutral, not only because he's getting more out of the lane while we are as well, but look at how much we also expended in order to get this kill, right? We have 6 stick charges, and we're not like a horrible spot regen-wise, but we did expend resources to get this kill. So not like, you don't have to think that it's like only an even trade in terms of what XP and stuff we're getting out of the lane, but it's also an even trade because we're ahead in lane. We don't want even trades. We don't want to be pushing the lane into them to give them XP. And notice that there, to get that kill, we had to push the lane. If this was like 230, 240, where right after this we could pull at 53, I think this kill would have been good. But I don't like this kill necessarily, because look at now, right after the kill, you're going to see the chance that the lane's going to push. And like, I have a double range creep, and normally I'd say I'm going to aggro the melee creeps to my range creeps here. But because of my spin killing him and the enemy creep wave, that's just not a viable option. So the lane's going to push, and we've lost control officially. And that makes that last kill, in my opinion, not worth it at all. And look at how much Bristleback's going to get out of this, right? He's barely level 2, or not even level 2, sorry. And now he's getting 2 whole range creeps and 3 melee creeps. Like, this is a level 1 Bristleback in the off lane that got virtually nothing out of the lane. And because we got that kill, look at all of this free. Like, yeah, he's missing the CS, but that is no denied creeps. He got almost a full level, if not a full level, on that wave alone, and he was getting virtually nothing out of this lane, and that is what we gave him by going for that kill. And that may seem like, yeah, you guys got the kill, great. I am reassuring you that that kill was absolutely a mistake. So something you can do, another tip and trick here, is that I'm A-clicking the Bristleback to drag my creep back, and you may be like, BSJ, why are you doing this? Well, he dragged the creeps away into his tower, 2 of mine. And now, if I keep dragging his enemy melee creep, the one that I have left, you can't see it on the screen right now, if I keep dragging it towards me, it's going to pull the lane equilibrium back. So, like, see this? I'm going to pull it back. And notice how that slight pull made my creeps stop just a bit earlier. They probably would have been just, like, 200, 300 units forward in the lane. And that's just these little slight things about lane equilibrium can be really beneficial to helping you manage it. And notice how there I pulled the creep aggro to my range creep again. And this is not a bad kill either, like the attempt. And I like the trade that we're getting out of it. But once again, like, I think that he doesn't die there if Bristleback's level 2 instead of level 3, right? And like, those extra damage from Quills really added up there in killing the Pudge. And the fact that he's level 3 is because we went for that first kill. So I don't mind the aggression there. And notice here that the reason why I'm trading with Ogre is that my range creep is below half. What does my range creep below half? Why is that significant? Like, why does that matter to me? If you're asking me, well, if I go aggressive and his melee creeps no longer deal any damage to my range creep, if it's not below half, it's living, right? It's not gonna die. But if it's below half, I can take time out of my day to go back and deny it, which you're most likely going to see here. But right now I can't do it because I am getting chased by the enemy heroes. And that's something you also have to recognize. It's not worth keeping lane equilibrium for yourself if you're losing out on resources. When I say resources, I mean health and mana. So you see here, we get another engagement. And all of these things are adding up, right? Like, I can't chase that Bristleback anymore. Look at my health and mana situation. And look at the fact that those extra levels of Quill Sprays he got from that first kill are really adding up. And that's, like, what we want to show here, is that was a crucial misstep in the lane. That's something that people probably just can't fathom. How can killing the enemy laner be a misstep? And, like, that's what we're showing here, is all, like, in the last replay we talked about how much they got out of the lane, and in the last replay we're going to show how big of a deal it can be that you just don't go for the kill. And it's going to be just a very similar example to this, but instead of going for the kill, we didn't. And you're going to see the impact that it has on the entire laning stage as we fast forward through that as well. And past this, like, yes, I'm more farmed than Bristle. I'm 21-11 and he's 9-1, right, in terms of last hits. And I'm level 5 1/3 and he's level 4.5. That seems like a very small discrepancy for the CS discrepancy that we see here. I have 11 denies compared to his 1, and he's barely a level behind me in a lane that we are completely favored and we had all of the advantage. He's not even a level behind me, excuse me. So notice here, like, I probably should have pulled a 53 here. This is a pretty big misstep. So the lane's pushing, and this is me failing to recognize the situation of the lane. It's 4:45, and I could have walked over and pulled the creeps because the lane's pushing in, and I had pretty good control of the lane in terms of mana and resources. So this is a pretty big misstep by me. And this is what I talked about, is how this was more towards the beginning of the patch, and I wasn't comfortable with the choices in terms of, like, going on the Bristleback for the first kill, as well as correcting the lane in this current patch. So you're noticing here that I definitely should have pulled a 53, even though it's not a huge option in this patch, like nearly as much as it used to be. It would have been a great option there to stack pull and deny the next wave, resetting the lane equilibrium and helping me out there. Another tip and trick right there is notice how the enemy creeps were going to attack my catapult, but I walked up and dragged them to me so that the creep wave would meet about where it is now instead of about 200 or 300 units forward. Anything you can do, anything you can come up with that just makes that equilibrium slightly closer to you could be really beneficial to the lane. Because like even though the lane's only about 200 or 300 units back, if you remember in the replay of the Ursa, I talked about how, you know, if they play around the tower range, that's basically their safety net when it comes to benefiting on the trades. So by having the lane be like 200 or 300 units back, like it would probably be about where their range creep is now, that basically doubles my area of being able to be aggressive, which that's a huge significant change if you think about it that way. You notice here, I'm pretty much trying to deny at any point, trying to pull it to my range creep. Not going to be enough though. Missed the last hit there. But either way, because of how I was denying the wave back, I'm able to get them to have an extra range creep. And this is something that you can do. They have an extra range creep here, and you can purposely leave it up, right? Even if it's low, making sure they don't get the deny. Like if it's within one hit, yes, you should go kill it. But making sure they don't get the deny, you can leave the range creep up such that it will push your lane back towards you, right? Any little thing that helps the lane, like do I want to pull the lane back? Do I want to push it forward? That's what you should be thinking at all times and then behave accordingly. And notice how I'm allowed to posture aggressively there because the lane is pulling towards me in the way that I want it to be. So like when I come back to the lane, unlike in the other replay, the lane is exactly what I want it to be doing. And so that's okay. Those are the kind of aggressions that are good. Like obviously it didn't work out there. He missed the hook, but if he had landed the hook, it could have been a really nice kill and it wouldn't have cost us anything in lane. So now, immediately recognize the difference between the last creep wave and this one. I had 3 enemy range creeps, and last creep wave, there were 2. And in last creep wave with the 2 range creeps, I purposely left it up so that it would pull the lane back towards me. But I like where the lane is right now. I don't want to push it too far back, and I like the fact that it is where it is. So I immediately shift my focus to just killing the range creeps. I don't want the lane pulling towards me too much. I still want it pulling towards me, as you see here with what I'm doing, but I don't want 3 range creeps running into my tower range so that I have to tank them the entire time. And that's how I behave in the lane. So now the lane's good. It's back to where I want it to be, but it probably could have been reset by the pull at 53 at the 5-minute mark. But the real thing that I want you guys to be, like, if you watch this replay even again, is just to see all the times that I'm pulling to kill my own range creep, and the fact that I am focusing on the lane equilibrium. And this time around, I actually am pushing the lane and planning to pull at 53. So this time I did not forget, and this is an immediate shift in focus to last patch, where I can pull at 53 to deny the next wave, which is still a viable strategy. It's just something that it's all, like I said in the last replay, just much more situational and not always an option. And something you should be doing in a lane like this. Notice how I'm basically denying him an entire creep wave. And it's really beneficial because even though they made it so that neutral creep denies still only deny 50% XP instead of like they used to deny 80% or more, that deny is 100% if you can keep the bristleback or whatever offlaner you're against away from the creep camp, right? And I'm able to bully him away in the current state of the lane because I have my ultimate. That it's really nice for me to pull at 53 and deny him that entire creep wave. I get a nice kill on him there with the Omni Slash, forcing him away from the creeps. That's one of those scenarios where I had a salve, so I knew that if it didn't work out, I would be okay. If I didn't have a salve there, I would not have gone for that kill because the lane would have probably been almost immediately lost, because I would have had to healing ward just to get health back. So notice here, I like where the lane is, so I'm actually just pushing it out like in terms of the range creep. Unfortunate crit to miss the CS there. Going for items as soon as I can. Notice how I'm always buying my items in the lane. Something that's like not the focus of this video, but I focused on a lot in other videos and had to talk to a lot of coaching students about. Just a friendly reminder. Noticing that I'm always getting the denies on range creeps. I'm always going for those denies. The range creeps are by far the most important to deny. Okay, so first thing. Their range creep was in front, so it died first. What do I do to solve this problem? Drag the creep aggro to my range creep. It's repetitive, guys, but it needs to be done by all of you if you want to win your lane as a carry. And now that I was able to deny that range creep, meaning that I took care of the lane equilibrium by killing my own range creep, that's when I was aggressive, right? I didn't go aggressive before that. I immediately back off when I know that, like, it's not a beneficial trade. My Pudge goes full ham. I don't think that would have been a kill for me. I think I would have died with him. And that's, you know, that's up for debate as well. But notice how after that kill attempt happens, the lane is still fine, right? Like, and now I'm going to push it out so that I can pull at 53. You may be like, well, BSJ, weren't you planning to pull at 53 and push in the lane there so you didn't have to do what you did with the range creep? Yes, like that is possible, right? But killing that range creep is still to my benefit right now because he still gains XP from that range creep. I chased him away from the XP of that range creep. If you remember, the part where I was aggressive was about when my range creep was gonna die. So he actually got zoned from the XP of that range creep. Something that you can do where you plan to have your range creep die and then you be aggressive right then and there and push them away from XP range. Like a whole nother aspect of the lane, but something you can focus on as a nice tip and trick for your lane. So I'm looking to pull again at 53, denying up this wave, going to accomplish the same thing once again. Now the ogre's bottom, so it becomes a little more complicated. Something to note, actually, is that the lane that spawns that gets here at 9, so meaning that when you pull at 53 at 9 minutes and later, that's when the creeps slow down, meaning that there is actually a shift in speed of the lane creeps in the safe lane. And that's just part of the balancing mechanic of Dota that they implemented a couple patches ago, and something to keep in mind. And I basically learned that in this game. Like, I knew that I should have known it before this game, but I didn't. And that's what I learned right here. Notice how I pulled at 53 in the new patch, and the old patch, it did not affect your ability to pull. And in this patch, if you pull at 53 at the 9-minute mark, your creeps don't get there in time. You see it there. They just don't get there in time. So I'm not actually going to pull successfully. I am going to stack successfully, but not pull successfully. And that's something really important to keep in mind, that you actually have to pull around 55, 56, and sometimes that won't stack based on what the composition of the creep camp is. So starting at 9 minutes, it makes it even harder to pull at 53, and another thing for you to consider as, like, something you factor into how you play the lane. So moving on from here, you pretty much see like how we handle the lane on my side of the on like how I wanted to win this lane and the way that I approached range creeps. And I don't think the rest of this lane is relevant. And it's important to just see that like how I came into the lane always calculating the lane equilibrium, and the few times I didn't, I pointed them out to you, right? Like, I could have done that part better, etc., etc. But every time I wanted the lane back, I was pulling it back. Every time I wanted the lane forward, I was pushing it. The most important thing that I'm saying here is that I always have that on my mind. And, like, something I've learned with my recent coaching sessions is that people don't think about this. And that's the key, right? Especially for 5K players or, like, a similar caliber. You know what you want. You just don't think about it, right? Like, if the lane's pushing too far, you know that you don't want it pushing anymore, but you don't, like, critically analyze, like, how can I pull the lane back? And that's what I'm looking for you guys to have on your mind at all times. Lane equilibrium should be one of the core focuses of your laning stage. Is it pushing? Is it pulling towards me? What do I want it to do? How do I do that? That's really your thought process and what it needs to be. And you're seeing that clear distinction between if you watch the replay of this and the replay of the 4K coaching student that I just had. So really quickly, we're going to jump into one last quick replay about showing how the first kill that we went for in this game, as well as the kill they went for in the first replay, is ignored. I purposely ignore that kill opportunity and how it's going to pay off in the future of the lane and what it ends up doing to the offlaner because I chose to do that and why I chose to do that. In this third replay, we're going to be showing you the quick example of how I purposely choose to not go for a kill with my teammates, why I choose not to go for that kill, and after that, we're going to fast forward just to show you how big of an impact that has on the lane because of like what it ends up doing to the offlaner and what he gets later on. So one thing I wanted to focus on is, remember in the last game how the Bristleback got about level 3 for free because of the fact that we killed him, right? And he otherwise would have been super low level. And later on, there were 2 or 3 engagements where that level 3 made a huge deal in terms of how much damage our Pudge took and he died, and also the fact that we couldn't man up on him and kill him another time. So you have to think, like, you know, what the impact of giving him that early level 3 is. And so a lot of offlaners, you think about it from their perspective, and if you play offlane yourself, you know that levels are kind of like a snowballing effect for you. If you get level 3 early, like say you get a level 3 at 2 minutes as compared to a level 3 at 4 minutes, that'll turn into like a level 6 at 6 minutes instead of a level 6 at like 11 minutes, right? It's like that extra 2 minutes that you got your level 3 earlier is going to make your level 6 come 5 minutes earlier. That's what I'm trying to say about a snowball effect of getting levels in the offlane. So if you can prevent them from getting that early start, if you watch pro games, you'll see a lot of teams really focus on that against like whatever the core offlaner is of the enemy team. That if you can slow down their start, it'll significantly slow down their impact in the game. Even if you only slow it down by about a minute in the early game, it'll slow it down by a lot more in the grand scheme of the game. So we're going to show you real quick. My teammates are going to go for a kill on this Nyx Assassin. So notice here, compared to last game, the enemy Nyx Assassin or the enemy offlaner blocked so that his range creep's in front. If I hadn't blocked for my range creep here, the lane would already be pushing. So it's kind of like if you don't do it and he does do it, you're in trouble. So you're going to see here that both range creeps, or his range creep's going to die first because it was farther in front of his creep wave. So in both my heroes right now, if you look at their perspective, are going for the kill. And I'm going to be quite frank with you. He's already stunned on Lion. And he has lift on Rubick, but this could have been an easy kill, right? I actually could have just walked forward, Rubick lifts him into me, I pounce him, he dies. He's level 1 Nyx, there's 3 heroes, we're going to have another Lion Impale like in 10 seconds, which if you count my pounce plus all the extra time, yes, he's just going to die. But look at the lane. If I leave the lane right now, what is the problem, right? What have we been talking about? If I leave the lane right now, and we kill this guy, what's the lane going to be doing? And the lane is going to be completely pushed in his favor. And that's going to give him a lot of XP and a lot of gold just because we killed him, right? And if you look at our lane, we have 2 stuns and a Slark against a solo offlaner. Ask yourself, is he going to get anything out of this lane if he doesn't get this free creep wave that he would get if we go for this kill? And the answer is simply no, if played properly by us. So instead of going for the kill, I choose to go for the deny on this range creep to make sure my lane is in the spot that I want. Notice how I'm focusing on purely denying, right? You notice how I kept attacking these creeps when they're medium health. Look, I'm ready to deny it the second that it hits, right? Look at that. I'm just hitting it as quickly as possible to pull it back. And this is exactly where I want the lane. And this is where you see the Nyx Assassin got harassed by my 2 supports. He's busy spending his time regenning at the shrine. And now my lane, like, he can't walk up, right? He saw what happened there, and he's only level 1. Notice I pulled the creep aggro to my range creep again. And I actually sent him 3 range creep, or 3 melee creeps. And this seems like a weird thing, but I saw him over here farming a jungle camp. That's what he's doing right now. So I actually sent 3 melee creeps down the lane so that I can keep these 2 melee creeps alive so that if he either has to choose between going for the jungle camp or going for these melee creeps. Seems like a weird thing to think about. Because I had the ward, I did that. I would not have done that without the ward. I would not have allowed those 3 melee creeps to leave like that. So fast forwarding, you're just going to see that the Nyx Assassin has a really tough lane because of what happened at the very beginning. I keep the lane where it is the entire time. He's getting bodied by my supports. And when you're a hero like Slark with a good start, and their offlaner has virtually nothing, it just turns into an immediate advantage for you. I'm allowed to pull at 53, as you see here, immediately capitalizing on that. Don't really get the pull off, but notice how, because I'm higher level, he comes into my lane, I'm like, it's not just enough to be higher level, guys. It's not just enough to gain this advantage. Watch immediately what I do with this advantage, right? He walks into my lane, he's gonna go for this range creep, like right now, and instead of going for the deny because I'm higher level, I say, no, you're not getting this range creep. Hit, 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 packed, pounce, have my Lion here, dead, right? And that's, like, you may ask, like, is it a coincidence that this guy dies? It's like, no, he's level 2. You have to factor in stat gains, you have to factor in level duration stuns, like, that would protect them, meaning, like, if you had higher level impale, it'd be a longer stun, it'd be more damage. All these trades are in our benefit because he's lower level. So we end up, even though we didn't get the pull successfully there, we did stack the camp, and I'm like pinging my team, like, hey, like, let's pull a 23. Like, we don't want to give this Nyx anything, right? So the minute he comes back, I'm still in this position to set it up to deny him whatever we need to deny him. which is perfectly, this is the perfect ideal scenario for shutting down the offlaner. And it wouldn't have worked if I hadn't tried to pull a 53. Even if the pull a 53 isn't successful, it did stack, which in this patch, that's the only difference, right? Is that you can't stack every minute. So having that stack go off at the odd minute marks, if possible, is really important towards having that be like an insurance policy for you. So notice here, the lane's pretty much over for this Nyx, right? Like I'm level 5, almost level 6. And he's level 2. So at this point, like, notice how the Pudge, right? How many times in your pub matches does the enemy send like a support roaming hero to your safe lane and they just bully you away? What you have to understand is that bullying that the enemy support's doing is highly based on the help he's going to get from the offlaner. And if that offlaner is level 2 and you're level 5, watch what's going to happen when they try to bully. Like, they're going to go on my line. Imagine if this Nyx is like similar level to me. I'd have to be scared of the Nyx, right? But they're going to go on my lion and I just walk over and say, get the hell out. And they have to. They just have to. And it's like, they can't threaten me because their Nyx assassin is still like ridiculously low leveled. He's still level 2.5. Like, and look at this. Look at the aggression that I'm able to apply on him, because even though there's a Pudge here, he's level 2 and I'm level 5 2/3, right? That's just such a huge discrepancy that, like, this pressure that they're trying to apply. People ask, like, why don't 7K players get pressured nearly as much as I do? And a lot of times it's because we handle the lane in the way that you're seeing here, where the offlaner's just shut down to the so much, like, he's shut down so much that they just can't do anything to you. Remember how I talked about at the beginning of this video, in the first replay, that most of your farm speed is hindered by the enemy being able to kill you. And right here, you're seeing them present no threat. And you're wondering, is this a coincidence that I win this mana battle by 15 health and get out, right? Is that a coincidence? If that Nyx assassin was level 3, I would have died there. It would have been 60 more magic damage from that stun. That is not a coincidence that we get that double kill, man up kill, right? So I immediately run back to base because I'm recognizing, if you want to be aggressive, you need to know what you need. I don't have mana. The courier was in use. So I decided I'm going back to base, getting mana as quickly as possible. And it's not like we're losing a ton out of lane. Like, yeah, the Nyx is getting a little bit, but like, my lion's still getting XP. It's not like we're just throwing away the lane. I'm going back to base, getting my ideal items, and setting myself up again to just go right back at it. And notice here that this lane advantage is just gonna keep spiraling. We're able to pull a 53, get a it's not a stack, but we're gonna be able to get where we stack our double wave. And this is when, if you're this far ahead, you can look to double waves up like this and just look to dive. That's what we're gonna do here. We have two range creeps, and we're gonna go for the deny or go for the kill here, because this Nyx assassin, quite frankly, walked out of position. And it's like, if he didn't do that, the lane would have been pushing and we would have looked to dive him. But since he walked out of position, we're able to punish it again because of the ridiculous level discrepancy that we have. And notice here that I'm just trying to be fast on farming. Like, at this point, I'm just trying to spiral my lead. And what I did there is I pulled the wave, looking to push the wave like as a double wave that I just talked about. And in this case, look, you're gonna see I'm gonna go for the kill, and I am so much higher level than him that I just do not care. That first resistance to go for the kill, meaning like I chose not to go for that first kill, has paid off huge dividends. I am 3-0-2 in a lane where I am now level 8.5 and the Nyx assassin's level 4.5. Do you think that I care about his existence as an offlaner? What if that Nyx is level 7 and I'm a level 7 Slark? If I'm at like 500 health or less, right, I have to be scared of farming. I have to slow down my lane farm because I can't use Pact. Because if I use Pact and he's sitting on top of me in his Vendetta and he ult stuns me, I'm dead, right? So that's like a big hindrance on my farm speed. But now, the way that this lane's played out, you just see the huge impact that that first decision made, and how it spiraled into just a ridiculous lead. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video all about, you know, focusing on lane equilibrium before aggression. And it's like how to win your lane. This is how you win your lane. And it's all revolved around range creeps. So I hope to hear back from you guys on the forums, as well as any comments and concerns you may have. And I hope you enjoyed this video.